entering your rest. I am entering my rest. Hallelujah. So Father, once again, just bless these lips of clay. Let me speak a word in season to us today. Holy Spirit, my senior partner, move. Heal the sick. Remove every burden. And let your name be glorified. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We are going into our promised land. Again, we have left our twilight zone. We have left our wilderness experience where things were not as they should be. Yes, we have come out of Egypt, but we are still on our journey into the promised land. The only reason why God delivers you from Egypt is to take you to the promised land. Somebody say amen. Amen. We know all that we have been talking about. And God is saying, it is time for my people to enjoy their rest. Yes. Hallelujah. Enjoy the rest. Because rest was God's original intention from the beginning of time. When he created Adam and Eve, he made sure he created everything. I mean, everything God created was so that it would cater to man's needs. Amen. That is why man was not only the last of his creation, but was also the apex of his creation. Are you here with me, somebody? Okay, man was to rule and to govern everything else and not the other way around. I want you to think about it. Because since sin entered the garden, since sin came into the midst, and man fell from grace, man fell from the glory, according to Romans 3:23, all have sinned and fallen what? Short of the glory. We have been displaced from our original habitat where we are supposed to thrive and grow and do what God has called us to do. Ever since then, it seems like there has been an upside down whereby man is now serving the things that was supposed to serve man. Amen? Today, people are serving trees. People are worshiping trees. True? People are worshiping the environment. I'm not here talking about, oh, just destroy the environment. But people are more concerned about the environment than human beings. Oh, please don't let me go here, Lord. There are some dog lovers here, but people will leave their inheritance to dogs and cats when people are hungry and... Alright, let me stop. Let me. Are you understanding? I mean, for the life of me, I came to America. Again, if you are a dog lover, I love you. Okay, I'm not stepping on anybody, but I'm just saying something here. When I came to America, now it's even going to Africa. When I came to America, man, I went to the grocery store and then I saw somebody pushing a cart and then there was something in the cart with clothes on. And somebody, they were talking to that thing, calling it my baby. I'm like, and then I saw there was a puppy, that was a dog. They were talking to that dog. He said, my baby. They put clothes on those dogs. They manicure them. Okay, I know I'm stepping on some toes. Now, I'm not offended by that. But what I'm saying is sometimes the things that we were supposed to govern and dominate, now they're the ones calling the shots. In some people's homes, the cat is the boss. Am I telling the truth or not? Okay. If it helps you, just say, ouch. We will keep going. But what I'm telling you is this, that you are the apex of God's creation. Someone say, I am the apex of God's creation. Everything is supposed to serve me. Everything is supposed to be at my commandment. You say, show me scripture. Yes, Psalm 8. He says, what is man that thou art mindful of him? The son of man that thou visited him. You created him and made him only lower than angels. That's what your King James says. But in the original, it says you made him only lower than who? Elohim, God himself, and placed all things under his feet. Folks, you are supposed to. Didn't Genesis say that? Hallelujah. God said, and he blessed man and told them to what? Be fruitful, multiply, subdue the earth, replenish the earth. He says, take dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over the cattle of the ground, and over everyone creeping them. I like that one. I have dominion over creeps. Somebody say, I have dominion over creeps. Therefore, I'm not afraid of the cockroach. I'm not afraid of the mice. I'm not afraid of the spider. Ooh. You have authority. Somebody say, I have authority. But you see, the reason why he really put the creeps there is because suddenly somebody decided to become a creep himself. You know who I'm talking about? Who am I talking about? The serpent. And who does he represent? The devil. So anytime you talk about you have dominion over creeps, think about the devil. Somebody say, I have dominion over the devil. And if I have dominion over the devil, it means I have dominion over sickness. I have dominion over sin. I have dominion over poverty. Are you seeing what I'm saying? Jesus said, I give you authority over what? Serpents and scorpions. And he tells you what those represent. And over every power of the devil. God created you to rule. Somebody say, I was created to rule. But for you to rule, it means that you are ruling from a place of rest. Let me ask you a question. Have you seen a king struggling for anything? His subjects may be struggling, but I've never seen a king who didn't have food to eat. If the king doesn't have food to eat, trouble is in town. Kings are resting. Rulers are resting. God created everything and then brought you on the seventh day and says he rested so that you can begin your life from a position of rest. But once again, sin has come to displace you to where instead of resting, we are wrestling. We are wrestling to survive. We are wrestling to get what we want. We are wrestling. You understand the difference? See, if you are not resting, you are wrestling. And if you are not if you are wrestling, you are not resting. How many people do you see don't have a good night's sleep because they are wondering how their tomorrow is going to be? Wrestling about their children. Wrestling about their finances. Wrestling about anything else. But if wrestling is what you are doing, then you are, I'll be honest with you, you are outside of God's original purpose and intention for your life. Oh, but someone will say, but didn't the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and all that stuff? Yes, the Bible says that we are not wrestling against flesh and blood, but you have to go before. In verse 10, he began by saying, be strong where? In the law and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of human beings. Of God. So what he's saying is that if even you are dealing with the enemy, you are not dealing with him in your own strength. And if you are not dealing with him in your own strength, then whose strength are you dealing with him in? God's strength. And so I rest in God and allow God to fight for me. Are you listening to me, somebody? And so we've been talking about entering that rest. And we said that according to Hebrews chapter 3, let's go there, verse 10. We have been discovering the secrets of how God is going to move us from our place of wrestling, from our place of the twilight zone, into our place of promise, into our place of rest. Because we found out that the first group of people that God spoke to about rest was the Israelites, his people. They were supposed to be a prototype. They were supposed to be a model of how God was going to change the whole world through his son. Are you here with me? God wanted the children of Israel to be a picture for you and I. Because all of mankind had fallen, he chose a group of people. And like my wife read earlier on in Deuteronomy chapter 7, in verse 1, he told you, don't go there, he told them that I did not pick you because you were strong. I did not pick you because you were a multitude. It wasn't anything that you did. I just chose you because I loved you. And I want to use you as a prototype, that people will see the way I love you, the way I work with you, to now see that, oh my goodness, if I can connect with the God of Israel, I can receive the same thing that the children of Israel are receiving. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians that everything he did for the children of Israel was an example for us who are going to be heirs of salvation. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And so we find out that they were supposed to enter their rest into their promised land. For the Israelites, it was a promised land. But for you and I, it's a land of promises. Are you understanding me? For them, it was a physical, geographical land with boundaries. Oh, I'm talking to somebody here. For you, it is not necessarily a physical, geographical land with boundaries, but it is a promise that has boundaries around it. It is something that God has said. If he says it's a land of healing, it's a land of prosperity, it's a land of breakthrough, it is a land of rest. Whatever you need, God says, I got it for you. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
And said, I'm going to put you there. But the Bible says that the people who had it first time did not end up in their rest. Why? Because of unbelief, number one. And because of disobedience, number two. And because they began to serve idols and different things. It's the same thing. We've talked about it already. That if you are in unbelief, you will end up in disobedience. And when you are in disobedience, you will end up doing things you are not supposed to do. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
But then one way we also found out is that the reason why they did not enter their rest, God says, wherefore I was grieved with that generation and said, they do always err in their heart and they have not known my ways. And so we are saying that if you don't know God's ways, you will automatically end up in unbelief and disobedience. And so it is behooving us to discover the ways of God. It is behooving us to understand how God works, how God moves. Because God is not going to change his methodology for anybody. Are you listening to me, somebody? That is the challenge that many people have. They want what they want from God their way and not God's way. And God says, I am God. I change not. If you want what I got for you, you got to position yourself the way I position you. Or I want you to position yourself. See, some people want to love God on their... thank you. Are you seeing what I'm saying? They want to love... And God said, no, you got to love me on my terms. You got to see. And it is all written here. Jesus said, if you love me, you will obey my commandments. And if you love me, my Father will love you and we will come and set our abode with you. John chapter 14 verse 21. And he says that we will manifest ourselves to you. And so you ask yourself the question, why am I not having Jesus and the Father? Why am I not experiencing more of the manifestations of God? However, I think that manifestation should be. Ask yourself the question, am I loving Jesus? If I'm loving Jesus, am I obeying his commandments? You understand what I'm saying? You can always trace what you are missing to a root cause. Because God will never lie. Somebody say, God will never lie. God is who he is, and he will not change his word for nobody. Therefore, if something is not happening that he said was going to happen, something is missing. It's not from God. I got to check myself. I got to ask myself the question, am I living by faith? Am I doing what God says? Do I know God's ways? If you know God's ways, you will get God's results. Somebody say amen. And so we have been talking about that. One of the ways we said was that the main way God works is through faith and through his word. God uses his word, or he works with his word. Somebody say he works with his word.
He works with his word.
Now, last week I spoke about seed time. How many of you were here? Amen. We said in Genesis chapter 8 that Bible says, God said, as long as the earth remains, seed time and what? Harvest shall not cease. Is that true? Seed time and harvest shall not cease. And what we say, what is the seed? Come on, those of you who were here last week, what is the seed?
Word.
According to Mark 4, Jesus says, the seed is the word. So God begins everything with a seed. And the seed is the word. The original foundation of a seed is the word. Therefore we said, if seed time harvest will never cease, it means that every word we are speaking is a seed. We are always sowing when we are speaking. God help me. For good or for bad. You are sowing when you are, you know, and the thing we said was that there is seed, there is time, and there is a harvest. So you keep speaking, depending on what you are saying, depending on what soil you are speaking into, depending on how you are responding by faith. I don't want to go all that, get the city from last week. There's always going to be harvest time. Somebody say there's always going to be a harvest time. I mean, I still have my seed and my apple over there. But it was amazing. I mean, I'm still meditating on this. And basically, the Holy Ghost just put me, Alfred, you cannot escape this fact. I want you to pay attention to it because there are some scriptures I want to show you. But I want to definitely by 12:30 kind of wrap up. There is a seed in every harvest. There is a seed in every harvest. But there is a harvest in every seed. You can never escape the relationship between a seed and a harvest. Where there is a seed, there is a what? A harvest somewhere. And wherever there is a harvest, there is a seed. They come hand in hand. That's why there is that old question, which one came first? The egg or the chicken? It doesn't matter. Because there is an egg in the chicken and there's a chicken in the egg. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me, somebody? We read in Genesis chapter 1, Genesis chapter 2. He said that everything he created, he said there was a seed in the fruit. And the fruit has seeds in it. And so every word you speak is potent with power. As a seed. But within that seed, there's a harvest. And what he was beginning to show me, because I go to some scriptures, is to let people also understand this. So we have established that it starts with a word. But it is not only a word that is a seed. Your actions are also seeds. That's what we're going today. Word and action. Will never pass. Oh, Holy Ghost, thank you. That's a paraphrase. Seed time harvest. Word and action will never pass away. You are seeds. Somebody say, I am a seed. And I am a harvest. Everything about me is a seed. My smile is a seed. So smile, come on. See, if you smile at me, you receive a harvest of a smile back. Everything you do is a seed. You are a walking seed. Oh my God, I hope somebody's getting what I'm talking about today. You are a walking, talking bundle of seed. You are like a sack of seed. Your whole being, every day, every attitude, everything you are doing, you are scattering seed everywhere. You can't escape from that. The question is, what type of seed are you releasing wherever you are? Because like I said, every seed has a harvest.
Amen.
There's one scripture that's coming to my spirit right now, a simple one. Proverbs is full of that. Read Proverbs a lot. It will bless you. Proverbs says it this way. If you want friends, show yourself one. So I need to, if somebody comes to me and told me, I don't know, nobody likes me. I don't have any friends. I'm not going to lay hands on you. Oh God help me. Because sometimes we use prayer. I'm a prayer guy by God's grace. But I've realized a long time ago, show me, some people hide behind prayer a lot. And yet don't see any results. Because some things are not a prayer problem.
Right.
Some of the things you are going through, it doesn't need prayer.
Amen.
You can pray I can pour oil upon you. I can lay hands, legs, feet, everything. It will still be the same. Change your seed. He didn't say, okay, thank God for prayer. But he didn't say that as long as the end remains, prayer will never cease. Seed, time, and harvest. So you come and tell me, I don't have any friends. The question I'm asking you is, are you friendly? Do you show yourself friendly? Trust me, if you go to the work and you have a smile on your face, you will get somebody to say good morning to you. Try it tomorrow. But trust me, you go to work and you're like, don't talk to me, I've not had my coffee yet. Okay, take yourself. What has coffee got to do with this? Oh, because one of the ways God works is through the power of a seed. Through the power of love. You want to be loved. So love. Another scripture, Galatians chapter 6. We read it last week. It says what? Let not any man think God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man, do you realize he didn't say God? Because he's dealing with earth. See, when it comes down to earth, the rules are different. Whatsoever a man soweth, that also shall he reap. If you sow into the spirit, of the spirit, you shall reap eternal life. If you sow into the flesh, of the flesh, you shall reap what? Corruption. So you ask yourself the question, am I sowing flesh words or am I sowing spirit words? Can I tell you something? Spirit words are potent with love.
Amen.
You can't sow flesh and there's love to it. Are you listening to me? And so it says, whatever, I like what he said, whatever, whatever. Somebody say, I am a whatever. Whatever a man shall sow, good or bad, that you shall reap.
Yes.
Without fail.
Amen.
But you see, me, I'm not a negative person. So this scripture encourages me. See, some people use it more on the negative. When somebody does something bad to them, that's when they quote that scripture. Whatever you sow, you shall reap. What about quoting it to me when I do something good to you?
Amen.
Yes. Are you listening to what I'm saying? Because it's the same thing. It's not a negative scripture. It's a positive scripture. I go into the whole thing in my day full of confidence that God is not mocked. Whatever I sow, I'm going to reap. So I'm going to sow something good to Amy. I'm going to sow something good to Flint. I'm going to keep on sowing because I know I shall reap. Is somebody here with me? That will enter into your rest. Now, quickly, let me take it into where we are. In terms of entering into the rest that God is calling us. Remember 2 weeks ago, I brought a scripture about Matthew 6:33. How many of you were here for that? Matthew 6:33. Hallelujah. Can somebody put Matthew 6:33 for me today? Uh-huh. Somebody remember. Bah! You know, don't forget the bah now. Amen. Bah! Seek first the kingdom of what? God. And his righteousness and all these things shall be added unto you. I don't have time to read all the whole thing, but you know how it starts. He starts from verse 24. He says, a man cannot serve two masters. Either he loves the one or he will hate the other. You cannot serve God and what? Mammon. What is Mammon? Mammon is the god of money, meaning that you make money your god. Money is not yours. It's not supposed to be your source. When money is your source, that's why your boss becomes your source. That is why your wealth becomes your boss or your idol. Are you here with me? But money was never made to be your source. In fact, I am the master of money.
Amen.
Amen. I command money. See, money is supposed to be a servant. You are supposed to command money to come and command money to go. Are you listening to me, somebody? But when money becomes your source, then money commands you to go and commands you to come. That's why you wake up and you are sleeping and you are clocking because money is sending you. Am I telling somebody the truth?
Amen.
And then you are tired, but you got to do that overtime. Because money tells you, if you don't go to the overtime, you are not going to pay your bills. The devil is a liar. God pays my bills, not money. He uses money. I hope I'm talking to somebody here today. I hope somebody's getting what I'm talking about. If you get this, you'll be free for the rest of your life.
Amen.
Not because you're not going to work, but because you go to work with a new understanding, with a new revelation, that I'm going on an assignment. That's why we believe in assignment, not job.
Amen.
J-O-B, just over broke. I rebuke that. Hallelujah. I go to work. I go, it's an assignment. I'm going to be a blessing to some people.
Amen.
And then they just happen to give me a paycheck. Praise the Lord. And the reason for the paycheck is to pay tithes.
Yeah.
I live to give and I give to live.
Yeah.
That is what that scripture is talking about. If you focus on Jesus, if you focus on the kingdom, he said, I'm going to take care of you. The only people who have to struggle to take care of themselves is the heathen. The people who have no covenant with me, God says. But then we spoke about how God began to compare animals and plants. Remember that? And so in verse number 26, Jesus says to them, why think you about what you shall eat? For behold the birds of the skies, right? They neither work, labor. They don't do any of those things. However, your Father in heaven takes good care of them. Oh, I'm like, man, I would like to be a bird.
Yes.
He says, aren't you much better than birds? Than the sparrow. In Luke chapter 12, he says, how much is a sparrow? Aren't you worth more than that? And yet your Father takes care of them. There is that song, you know, what's that song? His eyes is on the sparrow. You know that song? And he's watching over me. It is true. Believe it when you sing that. But then the second thing he says is, behold the lilies of the field. There's a word I want to introduce to you real quick. Behold the lilies of the field. Go with me for that one. They neither. Okay, why take you thought for your raiment? Consider the lilies of the field. How they grow. They toil not. Somebody tell me, why do they not toil? We talked about it last week. Why don't the lilies toil and yet they grow? People. Because why? Because they are connected to their souls. Remember last week we talked about how God created, spoke to the earth, and the lilies began to grow. Spoke to himself. Man came forth. As long as the lily is connected to the ground, it doesn't have to toil. It doesn't have to struggle. It will grow automatically. Remember what we said? We said, Jesus said that the kingdom of God is as a man sowing a seed and goes to sleep and doesn't know how the tree comes forth. But he says, day in, day out, he comes and first the blade, then the head of the blade, and when the harvest has come, he sets in the sickle. Remember that? What he's saying is that when you are connected to your source, who is your source?
God.
Come on, shout it. Who is my source?
God.
Who is my source?
God.
I heard somebody mention their workplace. No, I don't think so. Who is your source?
God.
Well, what's the name of your boss? What's the name of your boss? No. Your boss. Tomorrow you go to work, right? Do you have a boss? See, what's his name? Your supervisor. Just give me a name.
Morgan.
Okay. Is Morgan your source? So tomorrow when you go, you can love Morgan. You understand what I'm saying? You can show love to Morgan. Out of the love of God. And let him know that you are not my source, but I am here to serve you. I am here to fulfill an assignment. But who is my source? God is my source. And if God is my source, I cannot struggle. I should not struggle. I cannot toil. The word toil started outside of Eden. Pay attention, please, carefully. This will change the way we act and move, because rest is my portion. It says the lilies, they do not toil. Neither do they work on, neither do they spin their tails. Oh man, we are spinning. We are trying to count, wondering where this is going to come. We are spinning. They don't even spin. They don't, it's not hard work. It is not labor. And yet, I say unto you, that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Let me see the next one. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, where today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more, somebody say much more, clothe you, O ye of little faith? God is saying, if you will remain in me, I will give you the same resource that I give the lilies. But the word there is toil, labor. Go with me to Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. Let me show you another one. Proverbs, is somebody getting something here today? Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22. How many of you have seen this scripture before? The blessing of the Lord, it makes rich, and he added no sorrow with it. Let's break it down for a couple of minutes. I want you to take some of the things. It says, the blessing of the Lord, right? The blessing of the Lord, it maketh rich. Let me ask you a question. What makes rich? Going to work. Going to work. Going to work. What makes rich? It. The it there is referring to what? The blessing. And then he says, and he. So who is the he?
God.
The Lord. So the blessing will produce the rich. And he, God, will make sure that there is no sorrow to it. Someone said, what is the sorrow? Give me NIV. Look at the NIV real quick. Oh Lord, help me. Help me. Did you see that word there again? The blessing of the Lord brings what?
I think I like the word.
Without painful toil for it. What brings wealth? What brings wealth? The blessing. Not you going, working, spinning your thing. The blessing. So let me ask you a simple question. If you want wealth, do you chase after wealth? What do you go for? The blessing. The blessing. Somebody say, the blessing.
The blessing.
That is why he said in Matthew 6:33, but seek ye first the blessing. Seek ye first the kingdom. Because the kingdom is the blessing. What is the kingdom of God? Righteousness, peace, and joy. Where? So where is the kingdom of God? Oh, let me say it again. Alright, follow me. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy. Where?
In the Holy Ghost.
So let me ask you a question. Where is the kingdom of God?
Inside me.
Where is the kingdom of God?
Inside me.
What? No. Let's do it again. The kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. So where is the kingdom of God?
In
the Holy Ghost. Now, I know the Holy Ghost is inside you. Are you understanding me? But the scripture says it is in the Holy Ghost. Now, I know Jesus said the kingdom of God is in you. But the reason why the kingdom of God is in you is because the Holy Ghost is where? In you. So if you ignore the Holy Ghost, you ignore the kingdom. If you ignore the kingdom, you ignore the blessing. If you ignore the blessing, you ignore your wealth. And therefore you have toy. All right, well, is this too much? See, that tells you the more you learn to fellowship with the Holy Ghost, the more he begins to unveil the riches of his kingdom. Because the Holy Ghost is the presence of God. In his presence, there is what? Fullness of joy. See, the Holy Ghost is the key. The Holy Ghost is the key. He is the governor of the kingdom right now on earth. He is the one that causes everything to move. That means that he is the administrator of everything that God wants to do for you. That means that if you are going to seek the kingdom, you can't seek the kingdom without seeking first the Holy Ghost. A communion with the Holy Ghost. So the Bible said, Paul said, hallelujah, we do it, we call it the grace. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the what? Fellowship of the Holy Ghost be with you. Present continuous. It's not just enough to be born again and filled with the Holy Ghost 20 years ago. My question to you is this: are you still filled today? Are you still talking them tongues today? Are you still fellowship with the Holy Ghost today? Without him, you can miss out on it. The blessing of the Lord. In Deuteronomy chapter 8 verse 18, this is how God told the children of Israel. This is how he put it. He says, it is he that gives you power to get wealth. Did you read that? Have you seen that before? It says that when you are bringing into the kingdom, you can write it down, check it out later. Deuteronomy 8:18. He says that when I bring you into the land, like my wife was reading earlier on, where you did not have to work, I've given you the land. When you eat and you are full, do not forget that it was I who did it for you. For it is the power of God that gives you wealth. Therefore, combine that scripture with this. What is the power of God? It's the blessing. And the Holy Ghost is the power. How God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and what? Power. Come on, guys, follow me. When you are seeking the blessing is the original blessing that God gave Adam and Eve in the garden. When he blessed them, when he breathed into them, he empowered them to succeed. That's the meaning of the blessing. The divine empowerment of God to succeed when anybody else fails. Can I tell you something? When you discover this secret, it wouldn't matter where you work. It won't matter where you work. It will only matter where God sends you to work. See, because you will now be seeking assignment, not paycheck. When you discover this, you'll be looking for an assignment and not a paycheck. And somebody may try to offer you something bigger. But you ask yourself, is that what God wants me? There are people who have rejected promotions, who have rejected bigger money because it will transfer them somewhere where there was no church, nothing. And some people took it and went and backslid. They have the money, but now they are backsliding. Somebody else stayed and they are so fresh serving God, and God has blessed them. Which one do you want to be? Do you just want to live outside of the blessing of God? Or do you want to be in the blessing of God? Do you want to toil? Or do you want to rest? That's the question. That's the question. But can I tell you something? God, Jesus, came to deliver you from toil. Someone say, he came to deliver me from toil. I know I'm dealing with some religious stuff going on because, hallelujah, the religion and church has not helped us a lot, folks. I pray that you and I, because I've already told you, my assignment that God has given me is to take the people of God back to Eden. That is my assignment by the grace of God, to let people understand that you were made for eating, you were made for rest, so you can actually do what God has called you to do. Can I tell you something? If you really discover who you are, hallelujah, and you realize that money wasn't an option, you will take vacations, you will take missionary trips without wondering how you are going to pay your bills. But if you just focus on just making money and making a living, hallelujah, then you are going to find out that the devil is going to make you spin your tail and you end up not doing anything for God.
Amen.
But if you are eating and you are fellowshipping with the Holy Ghost, you are fellowshipping with God, like the Bible says, and God will come into the eating on the cool of the day. What is he coming to do? He's come to have chat with Adam. He's going to talk to Adam. He's going to fellowship with Adam. Adam wasn't worried about spending time with God, fearing if I spend 1 hour with God, I'm going to miss something on TV or miss something here and there. He's like, what else do I got to do? This is my life. I want to spend it in God. I want to do what God has called me to do. And I know God will provide all my needs according to his riches and glory. I don't have to toil. I don't have to wrestle. All I got to do is rest in him.
Yes.
But we got to realize that there is something we got to do. And so, two scriptures, Mark chapter 6 and John chapter 6, we said it 2 weeks ago. Jesus comes into a situation. He has preached the law. He has released the word. And now it's evening time. There's over 5,000 people. And Jesus looks at them and says to his disciples, in fact, the disciples come to him and say, Jesus, why don't you send these people home? For they have been with us for 3 days, fasting and not praying. They've been hungry. Let them go up before they faint. And then Jesus looks at the disciples and says to them, you give them something to what? Eat. And the disciples say, Jesus, we've heard some crazy things from you. But are you serious? Have you forgotten that we left our jobs and started following you? Where are we going to find money to feed this multitude? It will take a whole year's wage. So Jesus, are you that wicked? You're going to keep them hungry for a year for us to go work so that you see where they are going? See, their thought is just like you and I. God gives you a command. God tells you, start that business. You start giving excuses in your mind. How is not going to happen. Not how it's going to happen. God tells you, start a church. God tells you, go on a missionary trip. Whatever commandment. Because every commandment God will give you is an impossible commandment.
Yeah. Amen.
Did you read what my wife said before? He said, I'm sending you to take that land. Guess what? The people on that land are stronger than you.
Right.
7 nations stronger than you. But go take it. And then I'm like, what? He said, no, don't worry. I know you can't. Listen, if God gives you a command that you can, then go check again. It didn't come from God. You think when God spoke to us and said, it's time to start a church, I was like, it's about time, God. After I've been saving this money in my account, waiting for you to tell me. You thought we had a dime in the account? You thought we knew how many people were going to come? No. But I have learned 20 years working with him. He leads you into fights that he knows you can't win.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, somebody's not as happy as I am, but I'm happy anyway. He leads you into impossibilities. Why? Because you got to rely on him. You got to depend on him. He's going to give you assignments. He knows that you cannot win yourself. He's going to bring before your mouth. He says, there are giants. God, why are you even telling these people? He said, the giants there, you remember the Anaks? They are stronger and mighty. But he says, go. I'm giving you the land. Somebody say, I'm going because the land is mine. Jesus gives him an impossible task. Because in John chapter 6, he says, for he himself knew what he was going to do. But the thing about you and I is this. God, or you have an impossible task. You are looking at your mortgage. You are looking at your body. You are looking at your husband or your wife. You are looking at the marriage. And you are asking yourself, How can this be like Mary? How can I go ahead? Oh my goodness, I know, I can look at the faces here. Hallelujah. There are old men. Clap for the single mothers in this house. Come on. Look at this. I don't know how to do it. I know how to do it. Amen. I mean, you ask yourself, how am I going to do a full-time work, full-time mother, full-time father? I got to put food on the table, make sure they are in school and all that stuff. Can I come and tell you somebody that you got God on your side? If God knew that you could face what you are going through, he knew that it was impossible in your own strength, but he came to empower you with a blessing. He came to give you the blessing. It wouldn't have to take all that for you to be able to accomplish what God has called you to accomplish. I hope somebody is receiving faith to do beyond what you have ever done.
Yes.
See, but every time we come and face a challenge, our first thing is this: where am I going to find the money? We make it a money problem, not a faith problem. It is a faith project. Hallelujah. Somebody say it's a faith project. Look at somebody and say, whatever you are going through is
a faith project.
Rest in God.
Rest.
It's not a money problem. You are believing God. Oh, you don't have transportation. You don't have a car. Oh man, where am I going to find $10,000 to buy a car? Who told you needed $10,000 to buy a car?
Right.
Are you getting what I'm saying? Man, they are about to evict me. I don't have anywhere to stay. Man, where am I going to find a down payment? Where am I going to find the money? I have to work for a whole year. I have to save for a whole year. Who told you he's going to take all that? You said it. He didn't say it. That's what the disciples were saying. Jesus gives them an assignment and they say, where is the money? And Jesus says, oh man, you guys have been with me for 3 years. You don't know where my source is. Why are you trying to go work for a year to take care of 5,000 people? You know what? Tell them to rest. I'm talking to somebody. Tell them to sit down.
Yeah.
Tell them to arrange themselves. Tell them to just chill.
Yeah.
And then this is where we are going to hopefully finish this. He kicks in a principle from heaven. Did you realize that Jesus didn't just lift up his hands and pray and prayer started raining down from heaven? That would have violated sea, time, and hours.
Right.
Amen. Please pay attention to what I'm about. Jesus could have done it. He's God in the human flesh. See, but Jesus will not violate God's principle. Well, God told me this a while back. He said, Alfred, nothing moves from heaven until something has moved on earth. Can't have a harvest from heaven if there's no seed released on earth. As long as the earth remains, seed, time, harvest shall never cease. So Jesus sees an impossible situation. He knows that his Father can take care of it. But he says, before my Father can move, I have to activate a principle on earth. Is there any seed around? He asked the question. And they say, what do you mean? Well, I want a harvest of bread and fish. Therefore, I need a seed of what?
Bread
and fish. And he said, oh, there is a young man here. He has 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. And they ask the question, but what is this among that many? Jesus says, don't worry. That is just a seed. How many of you will eat this instead of this? You see this one? Some of you even can see it. Yeah, this was a 5 loaves. That's an apple seed. Uh-huh. But this is what you want, right? So Jesus says, they need this. He says, I need this. They need this, but I have to activate this. The disciple says, what is Jesus says, this will produce this. So God is saying, you don't have a harvest problem. What you have is a seed problem. If you cannot get the seed, I will activate the harvest. Through your words and through your actions.
Yes.
Somebody said, oh, he's about to raise an offering. Well, I am, but that's not what I'm talking about. That's what I mean. Because before today, you give your tithe and offerings, I want to activate something. Because I want you to say from now on, you begin to understand why we do our declarations over our offerings. It's not just the offering, and it's not just the declaration. It is the declaration with the offering. What you say and what you do. Some of us, we have been sowing seed, but we have been speaking evil on our seed. Learn from Jesus. He's teaching us his way. I'm going to feed 5,000 men. He takes a seed, but he doesn't just give the seed. He speaks over the seed. He lifts up the 5 loaves and says, Bible says he gave thanks. He was generous. Some of you, God has given you seed and then you cast it away. What's this? Jesus was thankful for his seed. Folks, be thankful for the seed you have. You are a seed. I hope somebody is hearing all that I'm saying. Your husband is a seed. Thank him for it. Thank God for him. Your wife is a seed. Thank God for her. The more you thank God for the seed, the more she's going to produce a harvest that you are looking for.
Yes.
Jesus. Your children are seeds. Be careful what you are saying over them.
Amen.
The more you give thanks to God for them. What is thanks? Again, speak over them.
Yes.
The seed of the word. And then they will begin to release the harvest of the seed you are speaking. But it goes hand in hand. Jesus didn't say, because I am God, let them sit down. Father, in the name of Jesus, release bread for them. God will say, how? Where am I going to get bread in heaven to release? Yeah, I sent manna back in the days. I'll stop sending manna down. I need a seed from earth.
Amen.
Brought in 5 loaves. Multiplied that seed. Fed 5,000 men. And after that, Jesus also made sure, oh God, after blessing 5,000 people, he also needed, and he said, the person who brought the seed has to go home with the harvest. So after the whole people were fed, how many baskets were left over? 12 baskets of bread and fish. Guess who took that baskets home? The little boy. He offered his 5 loaves. Went home carrying 12 baskets. His mother was like, son, what's that you are coming home with? Said, mother, the lunch you gave me, I just gave it to that master. The guy who has been healing the sick. And then he fed 5,000 people with my 5 loaves. And this is what was left over. Can I tell you that God is able to do exceeding abundantly upon all that you ask for faith, but he needs a seed to work with. Go with me to Luke chapter 5. Luke chapter 5. Let's see again. Out of the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses.
No.
Are you Luke chapter 5? Somebody say, I am a seed.
I am a seed.
And I have a seed.
And I have a seed.
I am going to sow it.
To sow it.
The most dangerous thing you can ever do with the seed is to keep it. But the most powerful thing you can do with the seed is to sow it. Someone say, I'm going to sow my seed.
I'm going to sow my seed.
Both my words and my actions. Are you in Luke chapter 5? Okay, check this one out. One day, as Jesus was standing by the lake of Gennesaret, the people were crowding around him and listening to the what? Word of God. Hallelujah. Because they pressed. I hope that somebody's going to learn this year to press to hear the word. Why? Because faith comes by what? Hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Please don't miss this because this is very powerful. They came to listen to the word. And any time you listen to the word, faith has no choice but to come. That's why I encourage people. I mean, some of you don't know. I mean, I'm home by myself sometimes. I am just listening to the word. Saturate your house. Sometimes if you can sleep with a little bit of noise, I encourage you. Put on the Bible app and let it play. You say, oh, but I'm not hearing it. Your spirit never sleeps.
Amen.
Your spirit never sleeps. That's why I encourage people who are going through stuff. I say, don't worry about it. Just keep coming to church. Just keep hearing the word. Remember what he said. Hallelujah. Once the word is sown, you don't know how it is growing. But some of you, if you look at yourself from now, from last year to now, suddenly you realize that I've changed.
Yeah.
But do you know when that change happened? No. It is a progressive change. Just like when a seed is growing. You planted that tomato seed. One day you came, it's already here like, You keep listening to the seed of the word. Faith will grow. Life will change. Even people are the one going to tell you something different about you. I'll just be hearing the word. They came to hear the word. And then he said, he saw at the water's edge two boats left there by the fishermen who were washing their nets. Hallelujah. Somebody say amen. He got into one of the boats. Somebody say, he's about to get into my boat. Oh, glory to God. Come on, somebody say, he's already in my boat. He said, the one belonging to Alfred. I don't know who Simon is, so allow me to put Alfred over there. Are you there with me, somebody? And then he asked him to put out a little from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the people from whose boat? From Amy's boat, I like that. From whose boat? Simon. Let me ask you a question. Do you think Simon was in the boat while Jesus was teaching? Yeah. Jesus doesn't know how to maneuver a boat. You think Simon just gave him the boat and Jesus was by himself in there? No. Simon was with him in the boat because you'll find out what happened. I'm saying that to say something. Simon, number one, was at the seashore. Jesus is teaching the word. Now Jesus said to us, Simon, give me the boat. Jesus is in the boat. Guess what? Simon goes with him. And Jesus is still teaching. Let me ask you a question. Do you think Simon is hearing the word?
Yes.
Do you think Peter is hearing the word?
Yes.
And if Peter is hearing the word, do you think faith is building up?
Yes.
But look at what is happening. Because at this point, Peter is ready to go home. Peter is mad. Peter is not a happy camper. Do you know why? You will find out. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch. Oh, Peter is like you and me. Simon answered, Master, we have worked hard all night and have caught nothing. Can you give me King James? Because there's a word there I want them to see. You saw it. What's Simon doing?
Toiling.
What's Simon doing?
Toiling.
And yet he caught what?
Nothing.
Oh, you didn't say it well. Nada.
Nada.
He caught zilch. He caught
zero.
Hard work is not a guarantee for success. For the race is not to the swift. The battle is not to the strong. Bread is not to the men of understanding and wise, but time and chance happen to them all. If they are connected with God, He's able to move the times and the seasons on your behalf. Simon says, Jesus, I made you a favor. You came at the wrong time. I am washing my nets to toil again tomorrow. My wife has cooked some chicken. I am ready to go sleep. I have toiled. How many people have felt that you have been toiling in your marriage? You have been toiling in your business. You have been toiling in life. You have been spinning. You have been working hard. You have clocked all the time clocks you can ever clock. You have done some overtime. And then after some time to take half of the money. And you don't know what to do with yourself. And you find yourself got nothing to show for. Do I have any answer?
Yeah.
Simon Peter. But somebody say there is hope.
Yes.
Jesus came to show Peter that you are in the wrong side of Eden. I got to take you back to your original purpose. I gotta take you back to Eden. See, because anytime you are toiling, you are outside Eden. The only place toil was outside Eden. When God said, get out of Eden, he says that now, with the sweat of your brow, you will eat bread. That's a curse. Somebody say, God has redeemed me from the curse. Toil is not for me. Jesus broke that toil from Peter. He said, I have toiled all night and caught nothing. I pray that today you will learn to stop toiling and learn to start trusting. Because the next verse, look at it, the next verse. Who about to go? The next verse. And I'm taking another. No. Go back, verse 5. And I'm taking another. Nevertheless, at one time, where I will let down the net. Let me tell you something real quick about this. Why do you think Peter has gotten to this point? Because he has been hearing the word. Faith has started building up. At the beginning of the journey, if any Joe Blow, anybody came and told Peter, without him hearing the word, and told Peter, why are you washing your hands? Come on, let's go back in there. He would have, you know, Peter can cut your ear off. You know, he's expert in doing that. He's like, I'm the expert. Because at this time, it's during the day. A professional fisherman does not go back in the sea in the day. The fish have gone to sleep. See, the fish are nocturnal. They come to the surface in the dawn time. That's when the fishermen go out to sea. At this point, in the natural, it was impossible to catch fish. But don't tell me that what is in the natural is impossible for God to do. When you have been hearing the word, it doesn't matter what time of day it is. That's what I was telling you. It doesn't matter what kind of work you do. If you will only obey the word from God. See, the word was spoken. Peter has received faith. Even though it doesn't make sense. He says, I've told all night. What difference is it going to make? Nevertheless. Folks, if you stay with the word of God, you will have a nevertheless in your life once in a while. You will say, yes, Lord, I have tried that credit place. I have done this before. And Jesus says, go back again. You will say, nevertheless, I'm going to do it one more time. Why? Because I have kept the word. Somebody put your hands together and say, I'm going to hear the word. Faith comes. But can I tell you something that Simon wasn't fully obedient? Can I show you? Jesus says, launch into the deep. And let down your what?
Nets.
How many nets?
Nets?
There was an S. Did you see that?
Yes.
Let down your nets for a calf. How many nets did Simon let down?
One.
I bet you have never seen that. He let down one. The one that he had not yet washed. The one that he was not going to use. He said, you know what, Jesus? I'm going to do what you tell me. That is why he almost lost the harvest. Oh my goodness. That is why he almost, after he let down that one, what happened? And when they had done this, they enclosed a great multitude of fish and their net. Can I ask you a question? If he had let down all the nets, see, so sometimes we preach it and we say, man, he let down, it was breaking. Yeah, that was almost a foolish thing. He could have lost that harvest. Some of you, you are losing your harvest because you have not been fully obedient.
Amen.
When Jesus said, let down the nets, go ahead and let down the nets. Do what he says to. Simon let down the net, it almost broke. His boat almost sank. I mean, Simon was about to go bankrupt out of the blessing of God. God will embarrass you.
Amen.
Oh, you didn't say amen.
Amen.
God can embarrass you with blessing. And then have to call his people. But based on what we are teaching today, let me go back and ask you a question. Did Simon fulfill seed time harvest? Did Simon fulfill seed time harvest? Because Simon has to qualify for a harvest. To qualify for a harvest, what do you have to do? Did Simon sow a seed?
Yes.
What seed did he sow? What seed did he sow? his boat. Did you see that? Did you see that? No. Because you have to understand it. See, I'm trying to tell you, it's not about your money. I'm not talking about money. Your house is a seed. I'm not saying give it away. Use it for the gospel.
Amen.
Your car is a seed. Amen. Oh, Jesus. I told you are a seed. See, whatever you give to God, he has to come. See, Jesus would have been, how do I call it? Would not have fulfilled God's edict if he had not come back. Because after he finished doing his business, after he finished preaching, something in him said, somebody just sowed a seed. They need a harvest. See, a seed will always provoke a harvest. Oh my goodness. Somebody say, a seed.
My seed
will always provoke a harvest. Please, again, I'm not just talking about your tithes and offerings. That is why I know without a shadow of a doubt, I will never be in need to pay my house. Because my house is a seed.
Amen.
I have Bible studies in my house. You think God will allow my house to go into foreclosure? If it goes into foreclosure, I may have to go and do what? Bible study in the homeless shelter. I refuse. You don't get what I'm saying? That is why, if you are looking for a new car, make sure that you add and say, God, if you give me that car, I will bring somebody to church. Make sure that you are willing to offer your house for somebody else. Are you listening to what I'm saying, folks? Everything about you, when you give it to God, when you give it to Jesus, when Jesus says, give me that, quickly give it to him. Because when he has finished using it, guess what is coming? He's going to tell you, let's launch into the deep for a catch. What you have not been able to catch for years, he can bring it to you in one day.
Yes.
If you give him what he's asking for. Last scripture, then we go. Acts chapter 6. Acts chapter 10. Just to prove you. Is somebody getting something here? For real. You are getting something. Somebody say, I have a seed. I'm going to release it. I'm going to give you this scripture, and then we're going to take an offering, and then we'll close. Alright. Look at this one. There was a certain man in Caesarea called Cornelius. You have heard the story before, right? A centurion of the band called the Italian Band. A devout man, and one that feared God with all his house, which gave much alms to the people, and prayed to God. You see how the two go, the word and the seed. Look at what happened. He saw in a vision, evidently, about the ninth hour of the day, an angel of God coming into him and saying unto him, Cornelius. And when he looked on him, he was afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And he said unto him, your prayers and what? Your alms are come up for a memorial before God. Not just your words, but your seed. And now send men to Joppa, call for one Simon, whose surname is Peter, and lodged with one Simon a tanner, whose house is by the seaside. He shall tell thee what you ought to do. Can I get you ready? This is a Gentile. And because of two things that he did, you and I are sitting here today. Do you know that he was the one, the first Gentile to receive the gospel? Are you listening to what I'm saying? Why? God said, your prayers and your alms, not less offerings, your alms have come up to me as a memorial. And every day I look at it and I'm like, I got to release a harvest to him. What does he need? He needs to hear the gospel. Therefore, I'm going to release an angel. Listen, your alms and your prayers will release angels on your behalf. I'm going to release an angel to come and talk to him and tell him to go call my chief apostle to come and tell him all about Jesus. Folks, I'm telling you that when you let your understanding of what your alms, your offering, your tithes, your seed is doing before God, your rest is the next day to come. Because God will never look down on your seed. Is somebody here with me? Again, let me say this. It is not just what we do here. Patience, can we get this right? It's not just what we do here in tithes and offerings. My question to you is this. Is there somebody amongst us who is in need that you can meet that need? Is somebody here with me? Why don't you look for opportunities to just be a blessing to somebody else? That is what the early church did. To the point the Bible says that there was no need amongst them. Oasis, I'm talking to us. If we are going to experience what God says, it is not the offering that you write your name that we come, that we see. Oh, but somebody may need a ride. Are you available to give them that ride? Somebody may need a place to stay for a night. Are you available to allow that person? Somebody may need a babysitter. You see where I'm going with this? Somebody may need a portion of your rent today. Folks, when you do it as unto the Lord, it is a seed. And God will look upon it, and you yourself will never find any need in your life that God will never meet. I don't have to know about it. Jesus says, when you give out, don't even talk about it. Yes. Nobody else will know about it. Listen, I'm talking about this because it's not because it's not happening, but I'm encouraging us that it has to become the norm because we are understanding when we are doing it. There are people sometimes who have come to me and said, oh, pastor, so and so, just bless me with this. I say, praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. If we intentionally go about sowing seeds, words of affirmation, words of thanksgiving, bless somebody. You see them carrying, you know, ask somebody sometime, do you have money for gas? Can I give you $10 for gas? Oh, trust me. You have a harvest coming. Someone say, I have a harvest coming. See, because rest will come. Not because you wrestle. Not because you toil. Not because you are trying to survive. God wants you to thrive in His presence. Stand on your feet. Put your hands together. Come on, someone put your hands together. That's all we have to get up. But I encourage you. Seed time and harvest will never cease. You have a seed. At this point, I want you to exercise what we have just talked about. I want you to take your envelope. I want you to take your offering, your tithe. You may have already prepared it. I'm not asking you to do anything different. I'm just asking you to obey God. I'm asking you to be like Peter. Not just with this seed, but from now on. You understand why we declare the declarations we put upon our seed. And after today, I challenge you. After you sow your seed, I want you to leave always speaking that my seed is working for me. Don't go back and dig out that seed. Don't go back and say, God, hallelujah, I don't know how I'm going to pay my rent. No. When there is a need come, you declare to the devil, you declare to heaven, you say, no, I sowed my seed. I'm going to reap a harvest. You begin to declare that my seed is working for me. You begin to declare that I am a tither. God said He opens the way. Are you listening to what I'm saying? You add your words to your seed. But sometimes we put a seed down and we leave and people begin to complain. Oh, you just threw your money away. The devil is a lie. Yes. You never throw your money away in the kingdom. You only throw it away when you put in the money and then you leave and go speak negative about what you did. But if you leave saying, I have a harvest coming. I believe that I received my harvest. Because God is my Father. Lift up that seed. Lift up your tithes. Lift up your offerings. Where's Marlon? Please come and help me out here. Father, in the name of Jesus. I have taught you something. I want you to begin to speak something over your seed. Come on. Speak something over your seed. Speak something over your seed. Speak something over your seed. Give God thanks. It may be all you have. But it is not all you have. Because pregnant in that seed is a harvest. It is connected to a harvest. This is just the beginning of what God is wanting to do in your life. Hallelujah. If you don't have any money, please see somebody. Today, just grab somebody. It could be $1. I don't care 10 cents. I don't care what it is. But make sure you have a seed in your hand. Because God is about to declare and prove to you. He said, my word will never go forth and return void unto me. It will go and accomplish what I send it to. Come on, somebody. Speak over it. Thank God for your seed. Say, God, this is my tithe. This is my offering. This is my seed. As I sow it into the kingdom, I believe for a harvest. I receive my harvest. I declare I have a harvest. I declare that I am receiving my harvest. All things are working together for my good. Heaven is opening over my life. I feel something here. I don't know about you, but God is about to change. Somebody is in God. Somebody is about to hear good news. Somebody is about to enter into their promise because you have become obedient. He said, if you are willing and obedient, you shall eat the fruit of the land. Sow your words and sow your offering. Become somebody like Cornelius. Become like Peter. I rebuke toil right now. Come on, lift up your hands. Today, Lord God, I stand, O God, as your voice, as your servant, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I take authority over the forces of darkness. I rebuke, O God, the spirit of toil, the spirit of strife, the spirit of struggling. Father, today, in the name of Jesus, I decree over these people that, Father God, that struggle is over. I declare, God, that striving is over. I declare, God, that wrestling is over. I speak over your tithe. I speak over your offering. I declare in the name of Jesus that harvest is coming. Heaven is opening up. Seed time harvest is your portion. There is power in your seed. There is power in your seed. I release it over your children. I release it over your finances. I release it over your body. I declare them all. Take your hands off the people of God. Father, we launch into the deep. And Father, Lord, we catch the mighty harvest. We let down the nets, not just the net. Father God, let us discover all the seeds that we have in us. And Father, help us to learn to sow into our marriage, into our children, into one another. I declare that in Oasis, there shall be no lack amongst the brethren. In Oasis, there shall not be poverty. Because we have abundant life. Oh, I declare it, you better receive it. I am taking it in the name of Jesus. This is my calling. This is my assignment. Eating is our portion. Abundant life. Divine health and prosperity. Father, we give you praise. In Jesus' name. Somebody say, this is my seed. It is connected to a harvest. I receive it by faith. I am a sower. Therefore, I'm a reaper. As I give, I receive. A hundredfold return is my portion. I enter my rest because of my seed. It becomes a memorial before God. Angels are released on my behalf. Heaven is open on my behalf. Signs and wonders are taking place in my life. I am a blessing. The blessing of the Lord, it makes me rich, adds no sorrow to it. I give God praise in Jesus' name. Amen.